Okay, so welcome to CSC 114. We basically today will go over the syllabus and the rules for the class. And I will also explain to you where the labs will appear in course documents, where the assignments will appear. I will tell you where, when our exams are, and we'll basically start the lab next week. So on Blackboard, you have your starting point for this class. And I put the link to the public course website. The public course website basically contains the lecture notes for the entire semester. I'm updating the lecture notes all the time. So basically right before the lecture, I may actually have a new updated version of the lecture notes. The lecture notes cover Java programming. And I believe that Java is actually one of the best languages for computer science one, because it's not as low level as C. In C, basically you have pointers, objects didn't appear until C++, but it's also more complex than Python. So Python has dynamic typing, so you don't have to define the types, but then basically you have the problem that you actually need to know more to actually understand what happens and what variables you are actually referring to if you are using dynamic typing. So I basically will also from time to time will reference what are the differences between different programming languages and maybe a little bit of history, how programming languages evolved from machine code to assembly, then abstractions like methods appeared, then abstractions as like objects appeared, and then higher level programming languages like C, C++, Java, Python, Lua, and so on. So let's return back to the Blackboard. So on Blackboard, you have the link to the course website. You have the Zoom for the lectures, and which you already know because you are all here, 109 students right now. Then you have the link to Piazza. So Piazza, I don't know if you have used it before. It's basically a platform for communication. You can put questions, you will see announcements when I will basically finish grading an assignment or the exam. I will actually post a message here saying that the homework or the assignment is available for you. Then you will also have other announcements here. I pinned the announcements that I find important, like for instance, the recordings for every single the list of all recordings for the classes and the labs, who are the TAs for every lab and where, when are the office hours. All office hours will be held on Google Meet. So basically we use Zoom for the class, but then Google Meet we are using for the office hours because anyone can join at any time. In fact, if multiple students want to get together to actually talk about the class, you can use the Google Meet that I created for this class. Okay, so let's return to Blackboard. One other thing that you will find on Blackboard are the list of computer science course clubs at Stony Brook. There is the Stony Brook Computing Society. It's actually as old as our department. Now it's hosted on Facebook. There are about 5,000 members, students that graduated, the current students. And the questions that you will see in those pages are about scheduling courses or the syllabus or the curriculum and so on. Then there is the Women in Computer Science that we had Fiona talking about it at the beginning of the class today, and the Stony Brook Game Developers. It's the third largest group for basically students at Stony Brook. The advisor for that group is Professor McKenna, Richard McKenna. You will probably take some classes with Professor McKenna. He's teaching the game courses, game development courses, the project capstone CSE 416 for our department, and also several of our other courses like software development and so on. You will find more links about VIX, the official website, Facebook group, Instagram, sign up for the mailing list, and direct email to VIX. Also, if you are interested to go to an internship this summer or the following summer, I can tell you that many of our students basically went on internships after taking CSE courses. I had a student that took CSE 114 with me, and the following summer he went to Bloomberg as an intern. I also listed a couple of companies that hire Stony Brook students, like Bank of America, Bloomberg, Citibank, JP Morgan, and so on, tech companies. And the easiest way to apply for internships is basically to search for the company name on Google and internship or jobs. And then probably the first link that is returned by Google is basically the link to the internship. Same for Microsoft or other companies. Most of these internships require a resume and 1 to 3 reference contacts. You can always give me as a contact since you are taking CSE 114 with me. For the resume, I advise you to actually write a resume as soon as possible so you can basically apply for these internships, even if it's in the fall. Also, if I remember well, VIX, Women in Computer Science, this group have meetings when they can go over the resume with you and help you improve your resume, even fake interviews, so you can basically get a feeling of how an interview goes. Now, returning back to our class, the labs will be under course documents. I will start posting the labs, in fact, tomorrow for the next week. Always the labs will be available before the weekend for the following week. Assignments will appear in assignments, and we'll have 7 assignments. I will go over the syllabus in a couple of moments. Okay. Now, on the public course website, you will find 2 pages. One is the page for lecture notes, and one is the page for the syllabus. Both of them have been updated for the spring of 2021. So if you see a different year here, please just refresh your page. That's all that you have to do. You can press F5 or just reload Control R. So what is this class about? This is an introduction to procedural and object-oriented programming. It doesn't require any prerequisite except math level 4 for the entrance exam. Basically, there is an advisory prerequisite, which is CSE 101, but I'm not requiring it. Basically, only thing that I want you to do is to keep pace with the class. So I will start with a basic introduction to Java. I will talk about variables, types, then loops, conditional statements, methods, and so on. So topics include many different things. We'll talk about how procedural programming evolved and how basically it's the same architecture that we had for the first computers, where you have a sequence of instructions that get executed. However, now you can also jump at other addresses to execute methods, a sequence of instructions defined somewhere else, and then you return to the caller after you call that method. Then we'll talk about data structures, and we'll start with the simplest data structures, arrays. Arrays are sequences of elements, a collection of elements. All elements are of the same type. So the advantage there is that you can find any element by multiplying the index in that array, which element you are looking for, with the size of an element. So you can get in a constant time, just a multiplication and an addition with the address of that array, the address of any element in that array. And you can modify its value or read its value. We'll also talk about classes. They were called records in some previous systems like C++. We'll talk about, when we talk about classes. So what exactly are classes? They are patterns. You want, let's say, to store a list of people. You can define that the person class has the following properties: name, address, age, and so on. So now you can create multiple instances of that pattern. So those are called objects. So you create person Paul, person John, person Mary, and so on. Now, you don't actually need to know how that class is implemented internally. That is called encapsulation. So as long as you have the public interface, how do you call the methods in that class, you can hide the internal implementation of the class and just use that public interface. That's the whole idea of encapsulation and information hiding. Then there is the concept in object-oriented programming of inheritance. If you define a superclass like person, and now you want to define subclasses, patterns for student, for faculty, for staff, and so on, you don't want to have duplication of code. You don't want to redefine that these are the fields defined in person, last name, first name, address, and so on. So you can basically inherit all the properties from the superclass and then define the additional properties defined for a student or for a faculty or for a staff member. But when you re-implement methods at the level of the subclasses, you have to basically rely on the system to call the most specific method for the object for which you are interested. So for instance, if you are looking, let's say, for the salary of a person, polymorphisms will give you this option that basically, even if there is a standard method salary in the superclass, is using when you call it for, let's say, a faculty, you get the faculty salary. So basically, polymorphisms allows you to use a range of objects where a superclass object is expected. We will also, so what I want to do this semester, by the end of the semester, I want you to be able to write simple programs that can do basic operations in an application. So input, output from files. I want you to be able to write a graphical user interface, to write basically a window that allows you to interact either for a simple game or for a simple program with a system. Now, one thing, so I mentioned methods earlier. So methods are basically like functions, seen as defined on real numbers with values in the codomain, real numbers. Seen as can be a method. However, in Java, when you define a function, sometimes it's not defined on the entire domain. So maybe it doesn't work on all reals. It's not defined for, let's say, zero in that domain. So in some cases, you may not return a value, but you are returning an exception, telling the caller that, sorry, it doesn't work for any value in the domain. In some cases, it will return an exception. Also, you have to take into consideration that sometimes in this function, you are actually reading something. So if the user enters some incorrect value, you're expecting an integer and you get some random string or a real, it will basically give you an exception back. It will tell you that something happened, I can't finish the method and return a value in the codomain, I will return instead an exception. So that's something that we will learn in this class. We'll basically learn how to deal with exceptions, how to catch them or throw them to the caller. Basically, we don't know what to do in that case and we just return an exception. The class also includes a required lab. So basically, every class, every lecture has a lab. And in some cases, actually, the lab is before the lecture because of scheduling issues. But I will basically prepare always the lab to address the material in the previous week. Because since there are labs prior to the lecture, I will basically make sure that every lab is about material that was already covered. The lab will use the same Zoom. And it will be taught by my TAs. So we actually went with my TAs how the lab is conducted. The TAs will basically share their screen. The first lab of the week will also be recorded. And it will be posted in these recordings that I had on Piazza. Basically, there will be lectures and labs. So even if you miss the lab per se, you can still solve the lab and submit it by the end of the week. So try to solve the lab during the week so you can basically submit the lab. The labs will be basically practice problems. The way that I see the difference between labs and assignments are that labs are lots of practice problems, like 5 practice problems per lab. You will basically, the TAs will share their screen. They will show you how to solve, let's say, 3 of them, and then we'll leave to you to solve the rest. Basically, you will solve all five of them, the three that the TA will showed you and the other two. And you have to submit them on Blackboard, basically like you would submit assignments. Homeworks are more complex problems. So usually a homework covers more complex problems similar to the lab, but you have to follow a strict definition how that file, how that program must work. So you have to use exactly the same signature for the methods, the same type of input parameters, and the result is expected to be correct. So labs are basically more like practice problems, and they are graded very loosely. Basically, we are looking over the code if it's correct, but we are not going to call the methods to make sure that they always return the correct value, as opposed to homeworks, which are more strict. And the grading schema is much more complex. Basically, for every method, we have an exact number of points that you will be assigned for that method. I have a YouTube channel for a previous semester, and I will also have a YouTube channel for this semester. So if you want to go ahead and to see what usually this class covers, you can always look previous recordings. But basically for everything that we cover this semester, I will make sure to put a recording right after the class or right after the lab. Okay. So I will actually make a separate YouTube channel. This is the YouTube channel for the summer of 2018. The last time that I taught this specific class. I teach, in fact, regularly every semester, the honors version of 114, CSC 160. But this semester I'm teaching 114 for the first time in 2 years. And there will be a new YouTube channel, CSC 114, spring 2021. My name is Paul Fodor. I'm a faculty at Stony Brook for 10 years, since 2010. I was previously a student at Stony Brook. I got my PhD in 2010 and my master in 2006 in this department. My office, unfortunately, this is a remote course, but my office is in the new computer science building, room 214. My office hours are on Google Meet. I will post the link here, are on Mondays and Wednesdays from 4 to 5:30. So this Google Meet, I think it's already posted in here. All office hours are on Google Meet. Okay, that's including mine. And in fact, some of you came yesterday for advising. Another place to find the same Google Meet for our office hours are on my course website. So if you go to my course website, you will find my office hour posted with the same Google Meet link. Okay. So let's actually go over the lecture notes that I prepared for today. So what this class is about? It's an introduction to procedural and object-oriented programming methodology, and the topics include programming structure or syntax of programs, conditional statements, iterative programming or loops, if you iterate over all the elements in a collection, or you have an index from 0 to n, n being the size of an array or the size of a string, and you want to iterate over every element. We will talk about procedures or methods, arrays, records or classes, object classes, encapsulation and information hiding, inheritance, polymorphisms, file input, output, and exceptions. The prerequisite for this class is level 4 or higher on the math placement exam, and the advisory prerequisite is CSE 101. Some of you, majority of you actually probably took CSE 101, computational thinking. The following goals are basically the ones that are evaluated by the commission that accredits our courses for a bachelor degree in computer science. And those are that at the end of this course, you will gain an ability to program in object-oriented programming using concepts such as classes, encapsulation, inheritance, and polymorphism, an ability to use fundamental data structures such as arrays, and an ability to program with sound code structure, basically debugging a program. So you will learn software debugging, testing techniques. So what exactly is the focus of the class? And this is kind of like our schedule for the semester. We'll start with introduction to programming in Java, conditional statements, loops, methods. Then we will move on to data structures such as arrays, lists, and stacks. A little bit of algorithms. We'll learn how to sort, for instance, find an element in a sorted array or not sorted array. We'll learn basic algorithms like selection sort, insertion sort, binary search, linear search, and so on. We will learn basic concepts of object-oriented programming, like what is a class, what is encapsulation, how to create objects, inheritance, polymorphism. As an application, we'll develop a graphical user interface. So basically, we'll learn how to write a standalone application on your own computers using a framework, a graphical user interface framework. We will have regular programming assignments every 2 weeks and 26 labs for the entire semester, twice per week, except the first week of classes. We need to cover something before we can have a lab. Now, if we go into detail, so first we start with procedural programming. We'll learn what are data types, what are variable declarations, how to assign values to variables, how to read and write from the standard input and standard output, the console or command prompt, how to manipulate text and strings. We will learn conditional statements, loops or iteration, and then methods. So this is basic procedural programming, and there is a midterm after we finish all about procedural programming. Then we'll talk about arrays. So we'll basically learn what first kind of data structures for you are, how to write algorithms to search, sort arrays, and other array manipulations like shifting elements in an array, randomly creating a permutation of elements in arrays, and so on. Then we'll move on to object-oriented programming. So we'll cover constructing and designing classes, aggregation, inheritance, polymorphism. As an application, we'll develop graphical user interfaces. My information is, as I told you earlier, basically my office hours are from 4 to 5:30. My phone number when I'm in the office is 631-632-9820. I will try to be in my office, at least during office hours, so you can also call me if you need. My email address is paul.fodor@stonybrook.edu. Please include also CSC114 in the email subject, because sometimes it's not enough to just ask when is homework X due, or can we go over our midterm, because I'm teaching multiple classes, two more classes. Again, the course website for all courses in computer science, we have a standard link, the computer science department followed by /CSC and then the course number. You will find at that address, in fact, the two sections, and you follow the section one. Blackboard will be used for assignments, grades, and other course material that needs to be protected. So the assignments need to be submitted by you. The grades are private. So every one of you will go to my grades and see the grades for your assignments, your exams, total grades, and so on. The meeting information is that we meet for the lecture on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 4:45 to 6:05 on Zoom. And we are going to use the same Zoom for the labs. So if your labs are Mondays, Wednesdays, 7:50 p.m., you basically have to join the lab at 7:50 p.m. My TAs are also added as co-hosts. So basically, they will host the lab. In fact, they basically need to host the lab so they can share their screen. But the lab is basically open. This Zoom link is open for you, again, to join anytime you want. And there are the other labs, Tuesdays and Thursdays for this class. One of the labs actually follows the class, and that basically it's about half an hour, 25 minutes after the class. Now, some of you asked this question on Piazza, what textbook we are using, and if we need to get my programming lab. And the answer to that is that the textbook that we are using is Introduction to Java Programming, the Comprehensive Edition. And the author is Daniel Young. The publisher is Pearson. The editor edition that I'm using is 11th edition, but it doesn't change that much between editions. So one thing that I can tell you is that if you have an older version, it's good enough. Basically, this book is optional. Everything that I will ask questions about is from my lecture notes. I developed lecture notes for this semester and the previous semesters that are very well detailed, and the problems that I give you as homeworks and labs are spelled out. Like, basically, you will be told what is the problem. Let's say, sort an array of nurses by age or by the number of hours they work and so on. So you don't, I will not make references to the textbook, solve problem number 5 from page 32. No, the textbook is really optional. The same with my programming lab. It's a tool that comes with the textbook. If you purchase the textbook, you will find on one of the pages of the textbook, maybe second page, an access code. That's an access code for you, if you own the textbook, to this system that comes with the textbook called My Programming Lab. It's a good system. It starts with very simple problems, like how do you define a variable? Int x equal 5, semicolon. Every statement in Java ends with semicolon. One thing that I basically can tell you is that it has a lot of exercises. Is if you have never programmed before, it may be useful for you to practice. But I do not count anything. I don't have a course opened on my programming lab. If you want, you can always join one of the previous semesters, and you will basically see the material and do the exercises. Any questions? You can stop me at any moment to ask questions about the class. Okay. Also, the software that you use in this class is completely free. So basically, you can download the Java Development Kit. There are many different, Java is a standard language that is implemented by many different companies. So there is a JDK that is offered by Oracle. And Oracle is basically the company that bought Sun, the company that developed Java. You should download JDK for your operating system. I will actually show you in a few moments what you should download based on what you own. Usually, I think there are only 3 different versions that may be of interest to you. If you have a Windows computer, you will probably download the 64-bit version of Java. If you have a Mac computer, you will definitely download the 64-bit version. And if you have some kind of Linux, like Ubuntu, Debian, SUSE, or other Linuxes, you basically will download the Linux version of JDK. Or you can actually on Linux easily install it with APK, basically APT. You basically, first time you try to run Java, it will tell you that it's not installed and these are the packages that may contain Java. On Linux, you will probably get the open JDK. So another version of JDK, not the one developed by Oracle, but actually by a community that develops source code, open source code. You can develop Java. Java is a compiler, really, that you can compile source code into binary code and execute it on the Java virtual machine. But you can write this code in any kind of text editor. Source code is a text file. So you can actually use any editor that you want, Notepad, Pico, Emacs, Vi, and so on. However, if you want a system that allows you to debug code, run it step by step, see the values of variables at different breakpoints in your program, you will probably need an integrated development environment. And Eclipse is such an example. Again, it's the one that I use. I'm used to it, but I know IntelliJ, NetBeans, that is actually developed by Oracle, and it's part of the Oracle version of Java. If you need help with any one of them, I can help you. However, I personally use Eclipse. I find it extremely well developed. I like a lot the debugger, the editor, and the file edit explorer, and so on. All of these come for free. There are IDEs that are not free, like IntelliJ. IntelliJ is available to Stony Brook students for free if you really need to. I see a few messages in the chat, so let me open the chat to make sure that there are no questions that I can. For some reason, I cannot open the chat right now. Okay. I will come back, and maybe you can always unmute yourself if you have a question. Right now, for some reason, Zoom doesn't open the chat. Yeah, still the same problem. Okay, any questions up to now? If you want, you can unmute yourself if you want to ask a question.
So does it matter which IDE we use?
Nope, absolutely not.
Okay, thanks.
Welcome.
Hello. And
regarding the textbook, probably there are some questions. Again, it's optional. I will follow the structure of the textbook to the letter, but as I said, you don't need the textbook if you don't want to purchase it. It is a very good textbook, I have to tell you. Basically, it's very up to date. The author also has a similar textbook for Python, also very well developed with a lot of problems, a lot of exercises, and I highly recommend it. But again, if you have an older version, or if you don't want to purchase it, it's fine with me. The reading materials from the textbook are associated with lecture notes, but again, it's just a more verbose version of what I cover in class.
Hello, I don't know if you already answered this, but I believe there's going to be two labs a week. So do we go to each of them or we go to one of them a week?
Each of them, as you do for the lecture. So the lecture is twice per week, same for the lab. Twice per week. Any other questions? Good. So let's go to the grading schema. So the grades will be based on the homeworks, exams, and labs based on the following formula. The homework assignments are 15% of the grade. The labs are 10% of the final grade. The midterms are 50%. There are two midterms of 25% each, and there is the final exam of 25%. So basically, the homework assignments will all have different number of points. So homework one, let's say that it has 10 points, homework two is 25 points, homework three is 30 points, and so on. Let's assume that we have three homeworks, okay, to simplify it. The problem. So homework one has some number of points. Homework two has also some number of points, maybe 15 points. Homework three has 25 points and so on. In the end, I will basically, and you earn some number of points out of those. So basically, let's say that maybe somebody didn't do homework one, they did completely homework two, they did partially homework three, and so on. So in the final, you have a total, and this will be 35 out of 50 points. No? So now we know that the homework corresponds, basically the 50 points correspond to 15% of the final grade. So if you earn 35%, the 35 points, you will basically get 35 multiplied with 15% divided by 50. So it's really basically you get that number of points in the total number of points that you earned out of the 15 points that in all the homeworks together count. Okay. So it's not the case that each homework is equally ranked in the final number of points. No, because some homeworks are easier. Like the first homework will be to implement a change maker. And some homeworks are more complex, like some homework may be actually asking for build a graphical user interface for a lab, okay, or for some counting of hours for nurses and things like that. So really, this is a percentage that is counted from the homeworks. How much of the homeworks have you solved? Similarly for labs. So labs are basically graded from 0 to 3. 0 is that you haven't attended the lab or you haven't submitted anything that is of value, like the code doesn't compile. 3 means that the lab was submitted correctly. Okay, and every problem is relatively correct. So basically, usually these labs are binary graded. It's either all or nothing.
Professor?
Yes.
Do you grade the homework based on completion or accuracy? Like if we complete the homework, do we get a higher grade? Or if it's accurate, we get a higher grade?
Both.
Oh, okay.
Yes. So basically, one concept that you will learn in computer science is sound and complete. Sound means that it's correct, and complete right. means that it returns all possible results. So basically, you have to submit everything to the best correctness that you can do.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome. Okay, however, the final grade is computed, what I can basically tell you, the best of both worlds. So basically, first there are cutoffs saying that over 95 is definitely an A. Over 90, you may the least grade that you can earn is an A minus. Between 90 and 95, the least grade is A minus. Between 87 and 90, the least grade is B plus, and so on. So basically, this defines that if you earn, let's say, 73, you get at least a C. Okay. And why am I saying at least? Because then there is the special rule. The special rule basically says that the average of the class, if all your grades, including the assignments, the recitation, in this case, there is no recitation or quizzes, the 3 exam grades, the labs are above the class average, then you're guaranteed to get a C in the class. So if the class average is 70 instead of 73, that means that with a 7, the entire grading cutoffs are actually shifted down with 3 points. So with a 70, you're still going to get a C. And let's say that you got a 77 or a 76, you're not getting a C, you're actually getting a C plus, because basically all the grading cutoffs were shifted down to that average. Okay, so the cutoffs, the strict cutoffs, guarantee that there's the minimum grade that you will get. The rounding that we have here, the special rule, kind of like a curve, basically says that the average of the class is guaranteed a C. So if the average is over 73, don't worry, these are the grades. Basically, if you get a 73, you will get a C, even if the average was 80, okay? But if the average is lower than 73, then the entire cutoffs are shifted down with that number of points. So it helps everybody. It helps somebody that got a 92 and will get an A instead of an A minus. It helps the student that got a C instead of a C minus, and so on. Okay. So that's why I call it the best of two worlds, because the fixed cutoffs are basically guaranteeing you that there's the minimum grade that you will get. And the special rule says that you may get a better grade than that minimum grade because the average of the class is below the cutoff. Okay. Any questions? Usually there are questions now about this. If not, that basically means that you understood.
Basically. I have a question.
Yeah.
In past years, what has been the average?
So it kind of depends on the semester, and you can see that in a pandemic semester or online semester, the averages are a little bit lower, because basically people are, there is a less incentive to do everything. Because if you get lost, like for instance, you cannot do a homework, you fell behind, And this happens quite a lot in a semester like this one, like the previous two semesters, when basically it was quite a bad situation. So in these semesters, it definitely helped. So the average was around 70, and then the entire cutoffs were basically reduced with 3 points or 4 points.
Okay, thank you.
I would say that there are semesters when the average is higher than the minimum for a C. So for instance, I can tell you that for the honors class, the average is much higher, is in the 80s. And that's not a problem. A lot of students will get A and A minuses and B pluses. And it's not a problem because basically these cutoffs guarantee that this is the minimum grade that you, if you got over 95, you are guaranteed an A, no matter what is the average in the class. So if all students get over 95, everybody gets an A. It's fine with me. That basically means that you learned a lot.
I see. Thank you.
Welcome. The important dates that you cannot miss unless you have an illness or some kind of extreme event are the midterms and the final exam. So the midterms are on Tuesdays, March 9th, during class time, so for 80 minutes, 4:45 to 6:05 p.m. The midterm two is on Thursday, April 8th, also during class time, is during the semester. And the final exam is fixed by the university schedule for final exams, which basically guarantees that for our time slot from 4:45 to 6:05, there is no other final that you need to take for another class, because this is our time slot for the final exam. The time slot that is listed on that university schedule is from 5:30 to 8. That's because it includes organization, like getting the exam, opening the browser and things like that. Our final is going to be limited to 2 hours. So basically you will access the final and you will take the final online. This semester is online. We are using Respondus lockdown browser. It's basically a browser like Chrome or Bing that only allows you to open one tab and doesn't allow you to go somewhere else, because basically what we want is that it's a closed book exam, that you take the exam with no other help but your mind when you take the exam, your brain. We are using monitoring, basically making sure that you are the one taking the exam and no one else, and you don't work in groups and things like that. So Respondus lockdown browser with monitoring is currently the most used in this university, because basically it's probably the least intrusive. Basically it records the video because we want to make sure that you are taking the exam, and it locks you into one window, and that's it, basically. Homeworks are due on fixed dates and times, and they are always announced at least 2 weeks before the due date. So for instance, tomorrow I will post the homework one, which will be due 2 weeks from tomorrow, on Friday at midnight, 2 weeks from tomorrow. No late submission is permitted. Basically, these homeworks are set up in such a way in Blackboard that you have 2 weeks to solve the homework. At midnight on the day of the homework is going to disappear from Blackboard. So basically you need to time yourself. When do you want to work on the homework? Start early and finish it before the deadline. Last moment issues are basically your problem. If let's say internet is not available at 11:58, it's because you didn't submit earlier. All assignments will be submitted on Blackboard, not the course website. This semester I'm not going to touch basically my programming lab. It's just on Blackboard in assignments. There will be homework due and you have to solve it and submit the Java files that are requested. The labs are simple coding exercises. You have the lab time to, and actually this semester again, because we are online, the end of both labs are due at the end of the week. So yes, there will be labs that are towards the week. Again, because I don't want you to be restricted to go to that lab. No, you can even watch the recording that it will be done by the TAs and solve the lab by the end of the week. Attendance, basically submitting is mandatory. If you want to submit your lab by the end of the week, you will get the credit for it. The grading is from 0 to 3 points, but everything will be factored into those 10% in the final grade. So again, there will be 26 labs. Each one is valued at most 3 points. We basically sum up all of your points from the labs, and then we factor them in the final grade. Usually it's binary. 0 if there is no submission, 3 if the submission is correct. I can tell you, I taught this class maybe 20 times since I'm a faculty, and it's always has been 0 to 3, nothing else, 0 or 3. Now, if you do need some kind of regrading, some issue happens. Like for instance, you thought that the homework was submitted, but when we try to grade it, it's not there, okay? Always try to check Blackboard to make sure that what you submitted is indeed uploaded in Blackboard. But if you do find some issues, you must see us within 1 week from the day that the grades are posted or mailed or announced. So this basically eliminates the case at the end of the semester, you are some number of points from some upper grade, and you say, let's look at all the labs for the entire semester. Maybe I can get some points. No, you have 1 week from the day that the grades are posted. I usually announce in Blackboard your lab or your homework or your exam. Grade is available. I will have 2 sets of office hours basically during a week, and you have to see me or you have to see a TA. All my TAs have office hours. Okay. And after that deadline passes, the grade is final. That's it. This is the schedule of the semester. So as I basically said, we start with an introduction to computers. We are 1 lecture behind, but that's not a problem. Probably I will not have time today to cover that lecture because basically we went over the syllabus quite a lot. But we'll cover introduction to computers next class, then basic elementary programming. The first lab will be just to make sure that you have installed on your machines JDK and an editor. Any editor will actually be good enough. Then we'll cover standard methods for mathematical functions, characters and loops and strings. We will cover methods, arrays, multidimensional arrays. We'll have a midterm. So the midterm is actually on the 6th week of classes. Then we'll cover object-oriented programming, like objects and classes, object-oriented thinking, inheritance and polymorphism, exceptions and text input-output, abstract classes and interfaces. And we'll have our second midterm. So the second midterm is on the 11th week of classes. Then we'll have a few lectures on graphic user interfaces. I want to make sure that at the end of this class, you are able to develop an application that is usable by other people than programmers. Not you ask somebody to run it in command line. No, I want you to be able to deliver a project to whoever he or she needs to basically run something, like for instance, a scheduling website for rooms in an Airbnb. Easy program to be used by, let's say, a parent of yours that wants to use it. And finally, we cover recursion. Certain type of problems in mathematics need a recursive definition. Basically, Fibonacci is an example. The nth element in Fibonacci is the sum of the previous 2 elements. It's a standard recursive problem. So you can compute f of 2 if you know f of 1 and f of 0. Okay. And recursion can be used for many kinds of problems. Like, for instance, Taurus of Hanoi is solved recursively, factorial is solved recursively, and so on. If you have a disability, please access the Student Accessibility Support Center. They have a phone number, also they have a website. All information and documentation is confidential. They will let me know about what kind of accessibility you have. And I will basically communicate only with you about any kind of accessibility support. Now, in this first lecture, I have to tell you about academic integrity. This is very important. And the following rules are posted in every course syllabus at Stony Brook. Each student must pursue his or her academic goals honestly and be personally accountable for all submitted work. Representing another person's work as your own is always wrong. And as faculty, we are required to report any suspected instance of academic dishonesty to academic judiciary. So, if we find that two homeworks are identical, that somebody helped you in the exam, let's say, and so on, well, we must report them. We must report them to academic judiciary. Okay. Now, what can you discuss on Piazza? You can discuss any kind of questions, general questions about the assignment, like, for instance, how to use tools, what the problem that actually asks for, like high level design issues, questions are always welcome. You may not share source code or full assignments or answers by copying, retyping, looking at, supplying files to other students. So basically it doesn't matter if you are the one that gave the homework away or the one that copied the homework or used it as his or her own. And I can tell you for every assignment and every problem, we actually use automatic tools developed at Stony Brook or like Moss at Stanford that basically takes all the assignments in the class and tells me between any two assignments, what is the similarity. So it basically tells me that 50% of this code is identical between these two students. Or 100% of the code, or 95% of the code. So it basically, it's easy for us to actually identify the code that is copied. And as I said, we must bring you to academic dishonesty charges. Now, I want to make sure that you understand what is academic dishonesty. So what is academic dishonesty? So most common case that I've encountered of academic dishonesty is that I find two homeworks that were identical. And the students basically tell me that we work together, but that's not allowed unless you have the explicit instructor permission that this is not an individual homework, this is a group homework. You're not allowed to work in a group on the same homework. Usually it's not even as a group, is one actually implements the homework and the other one just takes it and presents it as his own or her own. Also, it's not allowed to give your homework away before the deadline. So basically, you want to help somebody else, teach them to do something, tell them how to do it, but not providing them your own homework. Because in most cases, what will happen, they will not learn from that homework, they will just present it as theirs. And unfortunately, these days, there are public repositories like GitHub. If you put your homework online, you can do it, but after the deadline, or put it in a private repository. So I have no problem after the deadline for a homework. If you make it public, that's fine. The homework was due, was solved, graded, and we are done. But before the deadline, if you have a public repository, anyone can go there and take your code and present it as their own. It's exactly like giving it away to somebody else before the deadline. We don't put homeworks before programs before the deadline online in a public repository. Representing somebody else's source code as your own is obviously academic dishonesty. Buying and selling source code for homeworks is also academic dishonesty. Using pieces of code from the web is also academic dishonesty. I was once in a lab where I gave 5 problems for the lab. The student was basically, this was an in-person lab, and the student would take the problem definition and Google it. That's not what you are supposed to do. You are supposed to start solving the lab. Basically, think about how would I do this instead of just give me the solution, I will try to understand it. That's not, you have to practice a lot. If you want to be a good programmer, to get a job in a top 100 company, you need to basically work for it. Practice as much as you can. Now, another thing that you should know about academic dishonesty is that every instructor, once they make a recommendation to academic judiciary, they have to make a recommendation for punishment, basically. And cheating is cheating. No amount that is a little bit of cheating is only one homework, is not all the 7 homeworks, or is only one exam, is basically cheating. You are cheating yourself, in fact, because you're not practicing anymore. You're not trying to learn anything. You're basically copying. Okay, and our job is to teach the material and make sure that you learn it, and also to make sure that you are not copying. And the computer science department has a policy that if you cheat, you will basically, our recommendation to academic judiciary is an F. Okay. So it's not like zero. Like, for instance, if it's 0 for the assignment, then there is no incentive that you solve the assignment if you don't know it. So if you don't submit it, or you submit a copied code, you basically, in the worst case, you will get 0 for both, or you will, if you don't get caught, you get some number of points. That's not, there is no incentive not to copy in that case. So our incentive, incentive in some ways that you don't copy, is that you cheat, it's F, nothing else. Okay, and usually that's what it ends up in.
Professor?
Yes.
Do you offer any extra credits for us?
Yes, I put it in the syllabus. I will show you in a couple of seconds. Extra. So there will be extra credit problems as part of the quizzes and homework assignments, basically, and also maybe part. So usually what I do, there is a homework and then a bunch of methods at the end that are harder or more difficult to do. And those may actually increase your final grade with about 4%. So I stated here with less than 4%, basically telling you that it's not going to be more than 4%. 4% is the upper limit of that extra credit. Okay. So if you look at the grades cutoffs, they are 3 points, 4 points, and so on. So this 4% is really one letter grade increase. So if you do the extra credit, then you basically move from, let's say, a B to a B plus. So really this 4% will help those that of you that want to do the extra credit to get a better grade. Okay, it's in the syllabus.
Thank you, Professor.
Okay. Now, we are living, unfortunately, in a pandemic. So it may be the case that there is illness, some kind of an extreme event in the family. Immediately as you can, formulate a plan with me, with the College of Engineering and Applied Sciences Academic Advisor, to get back on track. Because my advice is that I've seen these kind of cases before. Once you start running late, you basically cannot catch up. So let's say that you get sick and you are out of commission for a week. And now, instead of learning the material that we cover this week, you are learning the previous week material. And next week you will learn this week's material, and so on. So you are always behind, especially in a situation like we are right now that we can all get COVID. We basically have to be very careful that if you get sick, as soon as you can, let me know and we will try to formulate a plan. Like basically, if you were out of commission for a week, then you have a week extension. So, or 2 weeks extension. So we have a buffer that you basically may end up with an incomplete in the class. So you can finish a little bit later based on when you get better, no? Or you basically get out of the situation. So basically it's just let me know, let the College of Engineering and Applied Sciences have advisors that can help you not only with my class, but with other classes that you are taking. Once you run late in one class, you probably will start running late in all classes. I'm also an undergraduate advisor in computer science, and I can tell you that the majority of cases that I see are extreme. Basically, either that the student is doing well, 3.8 GPA, or at some semester, you see a student that fails all classes. So it doesn't happen only in my class, it happens in all classes. So that's why I'm saying that make sure that basically we can help you to catch up. We are using Piazza this semester for communication. So you can post messages about the class, about the course material, questions about homeworks. Me, my TAs, your colleagues will basically respond to questions as soon as we can, okay? So any kind of questions that is of general interest, put it on Piazza. Basically, this way, we will respond as fast as possible. In fact, one semester, we got a message from Piazza that every question was answered in 3 minutes. That was the average. So you can imagine that some questions are put at midnight, and this was in CSE 114. So basically, we are prepared to respond. I have Piazza installed on my cell phone, and I get a beep, even if it's at midnight. Please, I mean, I will try to respond within a reasonable time. Now, there are things which are not appropriate to Piazza. So it's very important that you don't cyberbull anyone. You are polite. If you think that somebody doesn't understand the concept, you try to explain it. Don't basically degrade people by cyberbullying them, posting memes, complaining about a grade, about a class. Basically what I'm saying here is that it doesn't help anyone, okay? You can always come to my office hours. We'll basically discuss the issues. You can complain if you want in the course evaluations. I always read them to make sure that I respond in time in the next semester for any kind of issues that arise, okay? Also, don't post code, like source code from the homework before the deadline, okay? Posting the solution now will basically raise that other issue of academic dishonesty. In general, anything that is not related to the course is not a good material for Piazza, okay? So posting that, you're going on a trip, it's not for Piazza. You can post it on your own Facebook, Instagram, or whatever. Anonymous posting is turned off. You are actually able to post anonymous to your colleagues, but me as an instructor know exactly who you are, okay? So basically don't think that I do not know who is posting any message on Piazza. Also a little bit of an email etiquette. If you want to write emails to always use your stonybrook.edu email account. We cannot respond to other emails due to FERPA regulations. Like for instance, if you write an email from lily@gmail.com, I don't know if it's you, the student, or it's your parents or your dog, because they basically, you are not allowed to respond to other inquiries, but those that we know that come from the student. Okay. Use descriptive subjects like CSE 160, begin with a proper greeting. Hi, Professor Fodor. This is a question about your homework 2, my grade in homework 2. and end up with your name and net ID or student ID so I can identify who you are. So basically, in some of the cases, the email has your official name, but in Blackboard, you appear under a different name. So I don't know if Annie is Yan Hong, okay? Where do you get started? You get started on Blackboard. So basically follow the two links that are on Blackboard for the public lectures and to Piazza. Download JDK standard edition. I recommend to Google JDK 8 because that's basically, so Java Development Kit evolved. And I can tell you a little bit of history. We have a bit of time. So
I think the fifth edition was the latest version.
I think JDK.
The 15th, I think.
It's 15 now. But I'll tell you a little bit of history about Java. And Java was developed by the company called Sun. Okay. And they basically came for the first time with this concept that you write source code, you compile it in bytecode, and you can run it anywhere. Anywhere means that there is actually an interpreter on your machine called the Java Virtual Machine, which takes this compiled binary code called Java bytecode and can run it on whatever machine this JVM runs on. So basically, this is a middle layer that comes with this JDK, is Java Runtime Environment, which basically allows you to run the code that you've wrote anywhere. Okay, and this JVM came on basically all the operating systems at the time, Windows, Mac OS X, Linuxes, and so on. Now, at some point about in 2000s, Sun was purchased by Oracle. Okay. Java still continued to be developed in the same way until Java 8. So until Java 8, basically Java was an open language. And the license would allow you to develop a program and basically distribute it to anyone you want, even if it's for profit. After Java 8, basically Oracle changed the license. And the license now basically specifies that you can develop the program, but if you want to distribute the Java environment, virtual machine, you will have to actually pay a license fee. So basically, kind of Java diverged from Java 8 to a version that is maintained by Oracle and one that is maintained by OpenJDK. And this OpenJDK is what I want you to use. Basically, it gives you full control of what your programs are allowed to be distributed to after you develop them. So if I show you in my clips, basically.
I'm sorry, I have IntelliJ. Is it okay? IntelliJ.
Yes. I said earlier that
it's also professional.
Any editor that you want.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So I'm using Eclipse 2019, I believe, edition. Basically, I will show you how to start a new project. So let's create a new project for CSE 114. Here you can see that my version of JDK is 1.8.0, release 201. So basically I'm stuck to Java 1.8. One other issue with Java, so let me finish this project and then I will create a Java source code. So let's call it hello CSC 114. So this is a program. You see that the same name that the public class has, hello CSC 114, is the name of the file, hello CSE114.java. And then I have a main method, which is basically the entrance point for your execution. So here, any sequence of instructions will be executed in the order that they appear from top to bottom. So I can basically leave a message, system.out.println, I CSE114 students. Every statement in Java ends with semicolon. Then we may have other statements. So we have hi again. And bye. So now when we execute this program, basically you will see the messages in that order. Hi CSE114, then the next statement, hi again, then the next statement, bye. Okay. The advantage of having an IDE is that it also allows you to easily debug the program. So maybe you want to see step by step what happens. So you double click on the left hand side of the window, it creates a breakpoint. And now instead of running it, you are going to click on this bug, which opens a different perspective called debugger, a debugging perspective. So now it starts the program and it stops at that breakpoint that you created. So now you can execute this program step by step. So you execute the first statement, you see the output. You execute the next statement, you see the output. Then you execute the next statement and you see the output. There are two buttons here. One steps into, like basically this is a method, it will go to the definition of that method. And the other one is step over, which basically goes to the next one. Okay. Good. So now basically, and you can also see the values of variables. So let's finish this program. And we define a variable I of the type integer equal with one. Maybe later I'm going to increment I with one. So now, again, let's debug it. It goes to the debugger perspective. We can see that the value of I is one. And now I continue the code. I execute that statement and you can now see that the value of I is two. So basically you can see what happens in your program. This is the debugger. When you're done debugging, you stop your execution and you can return back to the Java perspective. Usually I swap between the two. One, the debugger shows you the variables and you can debug. The Java perspective takes you to the normal execution, the normal editor. Okay. So now, what do you need to write Java programs? The bare minimum approach is that you basically start with an editor, like even Notepad. You write your code in Notepad, you save it with the extension .java. The name of your file has to be the same with the name of your public class. You compile this code with a command called Java C, is the compiler for Java. The output is basically a class file, is a binary code. It can be tedious because now you have to actually execute it by running the Java command, that Java virtual machine. The second approach, the one that I recommend and that I showed you, is that you use an integrated development environment. Basically, you create a project like I did in Eclipse, and then you execute the program either by just executing the entire program or by executing step by step. It allows you to debug the program, make the code more efficient, you know, all the files that are in the project, how they are using other files and so on. And you can use any editor that you want. I will show everything in Eclipse because I'm used to it and I like it. There are issues that I don't like with other newer editors. IntelliJ is the one that I basically don't like the most because it has this extra annotations that they are added. They are not actually the code that they are developing. They are the type of methods or the type of parameters in functions and so on. You don't need that if you are a good programmer. So basically, I don't recommend it. I recommend using Eclipse. So how does Java work? Java is a compiled programming language. Basically, you write your source code into a Java file, then you compile it if you would do it from a command line with Java C, the compiler, the output will be a Java bytecode, executable code, which has an extension.class, the same name that you have to for your Java file. It's not humanly readable, it's binary code. Now you can run that program with the JVM, which is the Java command and the name of your program. Or if you are in the IDE, you just click on the run button. It does the compilation and the running in one single step. For this class, please be on time. Please show respect to your classmates. If you are unmuted, please turn off your phone, like basically I did. You should basically be considerate of the others. We are recording these lectures. You can stop me at any moment by asking questions, either by unmuting yourself or by writing them in the chat. Usually I have access to the chat, but I think I have to update my Zoom. Welcome to the class and enjoy learning programming. Any questions?
Hey, professor.
Oh, yeah,
sorry, you can go first. It's fine.
It's all good. You go
first. Okay, professor, will you be posting this semester's lecture notes after each lecture?
They are posted even now. From time to time, I'm going to update them. So basically, on the public course website, you can see that the lecture notes are already updated. But sometimes, like basically, let's say jump to lecture on selections. I might actually update the lecture right before the class. Now, this is actually for a different course. This is CSC 160. But it's actually okay. So lecture notes may be updated quite a lot, because as you can see here, the lecture notes are about the same material, but they are for the honors class. I would expect that there will be a simplified version for 114.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome. Trishi, you had a question too.
Hi, yeah, I just wanted to confirm something. So all the lab meetings will be recorded?
The first lab of every set, like basically there are four labs. I will ask the TAs of the first section to record it, because we don't need to record four labs, which are basically about the same material. So basically the first lab out of that four labs will be the one that we record the part in which the TA will show how to solve the problem. Basically, they will open their Eclipse and they will start running how they implement that specific set of problems. And they stop the recording after they finish that, basically how to solve the problem. And it will actually appear in Blackboard under the Zoom meeting for the class. You will have the recordings there, okay?
Okay, and so I get that they're only the important parts are recorded, but attendance is still mandatory, right, to all the lab meetings?
So if you want to ask questions about the lab, like for instance, you don't know how to solve something, the TAs are available and they are there in the lab. So that the lab is kind of like a common place where you do your lab, but you can always ask questions because the TAs are there to help you for that lab. If you cannot make the lab, you can watch the recording and solve the problems and submit them by the end of the week. So we don't take attendance. Like for instance, I don't know who are the 100 students that are now online, and I don't care in the end, because basically what I want is that the lab is submitted on Blackboard after you finish it.
Understood, thank you.
Welcome. So we don't take any kind of attendance. You don't need to attend your own lab. If you can't make your lab, you can go to another lab, or you can watch the online the recording. But in the same time, if you have problems, then you have no one to ask, because that's why the labs are there, to practice together. Okay, if there are no more questions, I will stop the recording and post it as soon as Zoom gives me back the recording. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a great day. Thank you. Have a great day.